Everybody, it's Evicta. 17 Intrigue here, the Binding of Isaac Evicta Repentance series. Yesterday's video did cross 5,000 likes, so we have another tally down below on the like streak counter. Now only 9 away from victory lap week, I should say, which is going to be a lot of fun and probably a little bit stressful. Okay, maybe a little bit more than just a little bit stressful, but either way, going to be a lot of fun. I know a lot of people are looking forward to it, so am I. Here's your meme of the day. This one brought to you by Squiglerain. Title of the thread was thought of this during the food associated with a show discussion. I always watch Invicta when I eat my lunch. When the upload isn't at 12 exactly, how am I supposed to eat my pizza without my Invicta? I don't know what the fish's voice is from SpongeBob. Even if it did, I probably would do a very bad rendition of it. Thank you very much to Squiglerain, all 260 of y'all who upvoted that one. Let's hop on in today. Hope you had a great start to your Thursday. He did give me November Bravo X-Ray Alpha Juliet 99 Delta. We've got great damage, but just god-awful tears rate. Our great damage is—it's kind of a little bit of a red herring in a sense that, oh my gosh, in the sense that it is because of the fact that we have the curved horn. Now, normally I would not be taking Samson's Chain, but I mean, for that amount of damage, I just gotta. So, Ease Mascara is going to give us even more of a stronger start here in terms of our damage. But again, as you can plainly see, the damage is not the problem here. It's going to be our DPS, which is in the form of horrible tears rate. And we just, of course, destroyed that by making it even more horrible thanks to Ease Mascara. But again, you see the damage that we're two-shotting Burning Clotties right now. That's on floor one. That is massive damage. And before we really get rocking and rolling here on this run, I want to say it's a little bit of a show announcement, a PSA networking announcement tonight for Thusmas, which starts at usually 5 p.m. Central, 6 p.m. Eastern, 3 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. I will be late for the show, so for those of you who watch the weekly Thusmas show, the Hutzvicta Ultra Super Mega Awesome show, I'm going to be late for it because I have an appointment with a Comcast tech who was supposed to come out here today at the time of this recording, but that was pushed to tomorrow, which is now today, because of the rain. So yeah, and the only time they could get that done was between 4 and 6. So yeah, expect there to be a little bit of delay in Thusmas. I just wanted to let everybody know. And I've already talked to Hutz. Hutz already knows. So, but yeah, we did get tears up. We got a shot speed up, and yeah, excellent damage so far. Curse of the Maze. Now, I didn't talk about our space bar item yet, but that is the Urn of Souls, or the Jar of Souls, whatever you want to call it. And it is fueled by souls, that little blue glowing thing that keeps getting sucked into our urn. You get them by killing stuff as long as you're holding onto the soul, the urn, I should say. You don't have to kill stuff with the urn to get the souls. You just have to be in possession of it. So you just, for the mouse and keyboard players like me out there, you just tap spacebar once. It will activate the urn, and then you just fire it like normal, like tears or whatever. You tap it again, and it will deactivate it. You get extra souls from bigger bosses and mini bosses. I don't think champions usually give you better souls or not. But it's capped out at 20, so yeah, it's a good amount of damage, but it's not reliable in boss fights. It's better for just room clearing and that sort of thing. If you can somehow get some sustainability with it, it is very, very good. But overall, it's kind of whatever. It's just a glorified blue candle that does its job very well, but it's nothing to really be too excited over, in my opinion, anyway. Get Purity. Purity is going to give us a stat boost based on the color. The red one that we currently have is obviously our damage. Oh, okay. And we just got teleported straight to Limehorn. All right, so we're doing 23.32 damage per shot right now, which is just... that's just phenomenal. Sure. Okay. Oh man, we're going ham here, boys and girls. This is the ultimate test of how confident are you in your damage to be able to keep you safe. Right now, very, obviously. Now, the only thing we don't want to get done is teleported into the curse room. Well, I guess we could for free, and then we can use the moon card to get out. But I don't really want that to happen because I want to kind of need a bomb. But it didn't matter because we can't get in there anyway, so... but, yeah. We're going to have to be very cautious, obviously, here with our HP. But as I just got done saying, I think that... it's well worth the risk here just for how much damage we're doing. We get money equals power. It's good, good, good. And Curse of the Blind. And the one hindrance that I do see, which should be painfully obvious by now, is the lack of movement speed. That is going to be pretty gnarly. I'm not going to take any blind items here. I don't really see... There's nothing that we could get in an item room. What is going on here with this? Okay. Yeah. I don't think we want any of that, but thank you for showing up. Thanks for coming out. Hey, it's great to see you. Yeah. Yeah, I don't remember sending you an invite, but hey, you know what? It's great to see you nonetheless. All right, thank you. Yeah, no, there's no food. I'm sorry. You can go now. Thank you. Hey, it's great to see you too. All right, bye bye. So we need to find the store, which is not over here. You get a little bit of a propulsion with the urn, by the way, so you may have seen me sneakily throw in a little cheeky dodge there. We'll fight the boss anyway, hoping that we get some HP. Pretty Junior is going to be kind of a little bit scary to go up against, but with the urn of souls plus our damage, it's not going to be that bad. Get perfection. We get meat, which is going to give us a nice damage upgrade. Yeah, I guess we just head on down. Now that we have some HP, I'm down with that. Sure. All right, perfection. And Curse of the Blind really, really does sort of kill your vibe for the entire floor. But there really is, I mean, we don't have enough, some people may be wondering, how can I skip the store on that one? We don't have enough money to really make an impact in the store unless we get lucky and somehow, some way, get a half-price soul heart. And even then, we may still need to use a bomb to get, like, say, a key or something like that. And it's just not worth it to us. It was worth it at the time whenever we needed HP. But after we got meat, that sort of took precedent over necessitating us to go into the store to get HP. Do you see what I mean? We still maintain the advantage of having a soul heart to help out our devil deal on this floor. And we also escape the one-hit KO from a champion. So, yeah, this is more along the lines of what we would want our bombs for, which is to get a high-quality premium item out of the store. In this case, is going to be the blanket. Blanket's going to give us the Holy Mantle effect every time we go into a boss room. And that Rotten Heart's going to be doing just buku amounts of damage. Like Mui, Trey, buku amounts of damage. Yep. This is what the Urn of Souls was designed to do here. Just absolutely roast and toast easy bosses like Fistula or ones that spawn ads. We do get a tiers upgrade and HP, and I guess we're just gonna get Guppy. Sure. I mean, you know, let's just freaking get Guppy. Who's gonna stop us? Nobody, that's who. And another Curse the Blind. Whatever game, you already done goofed game. It's over. Oh yeah, forgot, that's not Spectral. I'm gonna make it Spectral. So we get Guppy on floor 4, which is very surprising, and especially for Repentance. That is massive. Guppy's gonna give us Flying and the Mulligan effect, which these Mulligan flies that we have are going to be just dealing just tons of damage. This is another great practical application of Jar of Souls here, or Urn of Souls, whatever it's called. Allowing us to get through these armored knight heads. So where we, in the case that we don't have piercing, we now have piercing. Practically. Maybe Krampus. If there was ever a time that we wanted to see Krampus, it was on a Curse of the Blind, and you know. Urn of Souls is good, but Head of Krampus with this amount of damage, I think the Head of Krampus still scales off of your damage. I think. I could be wrong about that. I might be wrong about that. I'm probably wrong about that, but I think it still scales off your damage. Now, if we really, really, really needed to, we could go around. Oh my gosh, there's a planetarium too. What in the world, man? Happy Thursday indeed. Games feels bad for me not being able to show up on Thusmas on time anyway. There's still going to be a Thusmas, by the way. I'm just going to be late. To whom do I owe the pleasure of this? That's always a weird way of, like, greeting someone. I actually experienced that with the Comcast tech that I was speaking with via text message, because, like, they have a little Xfinity app that you can, you know, call in a tech call. And they lead off. The dude lead it off. He led off, not lead it off. Remember that we can speak somewhat proper English. He led off with, "To whom do I owe the pleasure of speaking with?" And I'm like, man, this ain't no. It ain't 1930 there, bud. It's like, you know, like who gets trained to say stuff like that? Like, that didn't make any dang sense. Like, I went to a wedding in Mexico, and every single host or hostess that was there, I don't want to call them butlers because they're not butlers. Every single hotel worker that was there, regardless of where they saw you, if you asked them to do something, they would always say, "It's my pleasure." Or my pleasure. It's kind of like, man, like, you don't have to say it. Like, you know, just say, "Hey, no problem." Hey, no problem. You know what I mean? Like, I understand that, like, they're supposed to be cordial and they're supposed to be, you know, somewhat formal and that sort of thing still. But it's just weird when they get forced to talk like that. You know, I don't know. It's like. It's kind of like the old way of, like, talking just doesn't make sense in this day and age. You know, like, you hear, like, if you ever watch, like, you ever watch old cartoons, like Charlie Brown, for example. It's who remembers Charlie Brown? Yeah, no, kids, you know who Charlie Brown is. Come on, oh, don't be dumb. You tell me you don't know who Charlie Brown is. Everybody knows Charlie. We've all seen that same Thanksgiving special every single year when it comes on. And I'm going to be honest, this might be a little bit of a hot take. Might be a little bit of a hot take, but Charlie Brown's not that good of a cartoon. I'm just saying there now, like, if you just happen to be a huge Charlie Brown fan out there, hey, you know, I'm not going to besmirch you for liking something that I just don't like. But I can honestly say without a shadow of a doubt, I have never laughed, not once, at a Charlie Brown cartoon. Ever. Ever. I think that there's like a... we got the tears up. So that was the first time we took damage in this run, I think. So you may have seen that the Purity Aura has now changed to blue. And that is the one that you want, really, is the tears up. Damage is nice. Tears is better. Loki had no chance. Unfortunately, we're not going to be able to get into the item room or the freaking planetarium, which is... That just feels wrong. That's not cool, man. How are you going to give us a planetarium and then not give us a way to get inside of the planetarium? Yeah, I was going to say, that's some buffalo banana bread buttery BS right there. I'm going to open this chest, too. I mean, I know it's Curse the Blind, but I don't want to pass up a planetarium. We'll pass up an item room. We'll pass up a store. But hey, when the planetarium's the cutoff. When we get to the planetarium quota, we're like, wait a second now, bud. Slow your roll there, Ace. Don't you know? You know, it's like we can't be skipping out on planetarium. That's insane. But you know what I mean? Like, you know, like if you watch something from like the 50s or the 60s, they like the actors, actresses, voice actors, voice actresses, they have a different timbre. They have different delivery on the lines, right? Yeah, well, we get another tiers up with Pluto. Size down, unfortunately. Or maybe fortunately, I don't know. Pluto with Samson's Chain should be pretty interesting. Yeah, like, I've never watched Charlie Brown and been like, man, this is hilarious. You know, like, hey, everybody, did you see the new Charlie Brown comic? Starter deck, pretty good. You know, I understand that, like, it's an iconic American? I'm pretty sure Charlie Brown's American. It's an American-made cartoon. Is it? Hang on. I have to... It has to be. Peanuts has to be an American comic strip. It has. I'm almost positive it is. Where was Charlie Brown created? Hometown paper. Peanuts has origin in Little Folks, a weekly planet or weekly panel cartoon that appeared in Scholl's hometown newspaper, the St. Pioneer Press, from 1950. That doesn't tell me what city this is in. Okay, Minnesota. Thank you. It's freaking okay. I just wanted to know where Charlie Brown was made so I can make a point about how not funny it is. Look, I know that like Charlie Brown is like, you know, it's an accomplishment of American cartoons and animation and that sort of thing. Like, I can appreciate all that stuff. I'm just saying that even if I was of age to be a kid and, like, you know, appreciate it as a cartoon, it still wasn't funny. Like, you look at, like, the Jetsons or, like, the Flintstones or stuff like that. It's like, man, these are historic. These are, like, iconic characters and iconic shows and achievements of animation, yada yada yada. But man, they're just not doing it for me. They're just not funny, you know. And I'm not even talking like an adult here. I mean, I remember I wasn't like very old when like that was still in rerun. I mean, they used to show it on like TBS or whatever channel that was. You know, like, I remember, like, trying to get them, like, you know, it's cartoons. You're home on a sick day. It's like, hey, that's better than watching, you know, Price is Right for a billionth time. And don't even try to say, like, oh, that's blasphemous. Look, I love Bob Barker like the rest of any you know, kid who had to stay after or stay home from being sick. But look, Price is Right got old after a while, all right? It's enjoyable. Sure, everyone loves Plinko. Everyone loves Bob. But, like, I mean, after a while, it's like, man. It's people yelling, man. Like, the games are cool, but when they play the not cool games, you know, like the ones where it's like it's the same car, it's the same oven because no one else won it from the week before. It's like, eh. It's either give me Mountain Climbers or give me Plinko. That's all I want to see. Yeah, but watching the old, like, Flintstone cartoons, the reruns and stuff like that when you were a kid was just like, it's just like, man, I guess this is what humor was back in, like, the 50s and 60s. And here, you know, here in the modern world and in the world with color, I mean, you know, it's not nearly as funny. We're way ahead of schedule here. I'm going to turn around and go to Boss Rush real quick. That's what I was originally going to do with that Stars card, then I accidentally used it because I saw the Hierophant card, got excited, and then hit the panic button. I don't know. I think, like, your perspective on things change drastically if you see stuff that wasn't from, I guess, like, your era. You know, it's kind of like you've all seen those articles where it's a picture gallery of where people are like, you know, people just used to age different. You know, like they would show someone from like the 30s who was like, this was my grandfather when he was, when he was about, when he just graduated high school, like he was 18. You look at him, it's like my dude over here looking like he's like 40. You know, people just don't age the same way that they do now. It just doesn't happen. You know, you look at like a 20-year-old from like the 1970s, you're like, man, like you put a 20-year-old, let's say a 21-year-old next to from the 1970s, put them next to another 21-year-old from like the 2020s, and the one from the 70s looks like it could be the one from the 2020s, like grandmother or grandfather. I mean, like, I've seen pictures of my dad, right? I've seen pictures of my dad when he was, like, 23, 24. I'm like, that's, like, you were only 23, 24 in that picture? Like, you look old, man. You know, I have pictures of when I was, like, 21, 22. Like, I look 21, 22. I look actually younger than I was. I'm like, man, like, it's weird. It's weird. I'm fully on behind the idea that I think that our eyes go through some kind of like weird age, like time dilation gap, where we know that we're looking at someone who is not of our like era, and we perceive them to be much older than they actually looked like, you know, in the pictures. But if we'd seen them in real life, we would know that, yeah, you know, your mom still looked young when she was 18. She didn't look like this, like that. But it's kind of suspect when you see these galleries of people posting pictures of their fathers and grandfathers and stuff. And it's like, dude, they already look old and they're only 16. Another Curse of the Blind. This is our third one now. I always wondered how come like stuff from that era, from like pre-90s stuff, and even then like 90s stuff wasn't that funny. Like, I remember as a kid we would watch like TGIF, well, those Family Matters and whatever the other shows were that no one cared about. You know, the one with Jaleel White and Steve Urkel. You know, that, like, I remember watching those and like, you know, you hear that all the audience is laughing. It's taped in front of a live studio audience, blah, blah, blah. And like, I don't ever remember even chuckling at those. And I'm not saying that I have some kind of weird, like, highbrow humor or anything like that. It just wasn't funny to me. Like, TV was just never that funny to me. You know what show legitimately made me laugh? It was canceled and then it was renewed out of nowhere due to popular demand and then canceled again after a second or third season. It was Titus, which was based off the comedy of the stand-up comedian Christopher Titus. It was, you know, it was like in the early 2000s maybe, where you know, it was just based off his stand-up, and I'd never watched stand-up before. I mean, you know, that just wasn't the thing back then, you know. But I remember us watching, that's when I used to be big into wrestling, and we would be watching something, and afterwards, like, something would come up on Fox, and we're like, yeah, you know, let's just watch it, whatever, because that's the only thing we had at the time. And then this show Titus comes on, and we see, we're like, you know, it's a sitcom, but sure, let's give it a chance here. Abba Dabba Ding Dong and Multidimensional Baby. That show had some legitimate laughs in there, and Stacy Keach, who played he was the actor who played Titus's the portrayal of Titus's real life father, was hilarious in that. Now, I would say that by today's standard, the show would probably have already gotten canceled on Twitter because, you know, Twitter. It was considered edgy at the time, I suppose. I mean, I wasn't really that old enough to understand. But it was, all I know is that it was funny. It was funny as all hell. I remember us watching, me and my good friends at the time, we would watch like the same episodes over again just because it was so funny. You know, and I recently looked up a couple episodes online, and turns out it's still pretty funny. You know, this is like what, like 15, 20 years ago now at this point, something like that. But yeah, it still holds up, you know. But you go watch an episode of like Family Matters or something, and it's like, I mean, you know, it's campy, sure, you know, it's nostalgic, but it was never funny. Let's not kid ourselves, you know. I've laughed more in an episode of Pokemon than I've ever laughed on any vintage cartoon combined. I think that's safe to say. So, like, you put Looney Tunes there, you put Mickey Mouse, you put, you know, you put your DuckTales, you put your... I never watched Tailspin. Was that it? Oh, Darkwing Duck? Something like that. You know, Alvin and the Chipmunks, Charlie Brown, Jetsons, Flintstones, all of them. I've never laughed at any of them. But I laughed my rear end off in a particular episode of Pokemon. If you don't know which one I'm talking about, I actually tweeted, this was like, I don't know, last year at some point. I found the clip and I had to record it and put it on Twitter just because I hadn't seen it in... what, like almost 20 years? And it's the scene where Team Rocket jumps on there. It's the one where like they're supposed to be excavating or something, and like they're, this Team Rocket's using dynamite or something like that, and you know, Ash and Brock and Misty and Pikachu, they're all there to try to like stop Team Rocket. Wow, that was a very, very useful hit of Krampus there. It's the one where like they jump on the pile and they try to stop Team Rocket from blowing up this excavation site. I don't remember what the premise of the plot was. Anyway, like it, like there's a big fight that happens and Team Rocket escalates and they bring out all their Pokemon. So Ash and Brock, you know, and Misty, they bring out their Pokemon, and then they end up all like just dogpiling on top of each other. So there's a big scrum. Like it's just a classic cartoon character scrum in the middle of this quarry when there's dynamite around, and Pikachu breaks free out of the group. I don't know how, but he somehow breaks free, and then for whatever reason, like because they're trying at this point the fuse has been lit and is heading towards this huge cache of like dynamite, and both Team Rocket and Ash's people, They're all like, we got to stop this, like, or we are like legit dead. And so they start panicking, but because they're all intertwined with each other, because they were like fighting with each other, they can't move. And somehow Pikachu is the only one who was able to move. And Ash is like, oh, you got to stop it, like, you know, it's gonna blow and that sort of thing. And so I don't know why he did this, but for some odd reason, Pikachu just gets the bright idea to use a thunderbolt on the barrel of dynamite. I guess he thought that he was going to be able to stop the wick or something, but he instantly regrets it. and everyone stops their yelling and stops their panicking or whatever. They just look at Pikachu like, why? Why? And then there's a big, like, zoom out on Pikachu, and he makes this really weird, like Pika sound. And it's and then, of course, it explodes because, you know, thunder and explosive TNT doesn't usually, you know, jive well together. That one scene in that one episode of Pokemon made me laugh harder than I ever did on any of those other cartoons that I mentioned combined. Anyway, welcome to the Binding of Isaac, everyone. How did we even get on that tangent? I don't even remember this one. Oh, Charlie Brown. That's right. Charlie Brown. Yeah, people just talked differently back then. No, it's like, it'd be my pleasure. What? Just say, okay. Like, no problem. Sure thing. You got it. Hey, don't say like it'd be my pleasure. To whom do I have the pleasure of speaking with today, sir? Oh, man. I don't know. Who are you? Like, tell me about you. How about that? No? I mean, it's my job to sit here and just talk to myself for hours and hours and hours a week. Every single week. Every single day. I want to hear about you, you know? Let me hear about you. What makes you tick? Ravi, whatever his name was, I forget. Serious Liquid gonna just jack up the pain. We've been on autopilot for a while on this episode. One of these super banter-rich episodes, because, I mean, really, like, there's nothing to really talk about in this Isaac run. We're just... It's been go from the word go. And we've just been dominating. Now, I will say that Pluto kind of adds a little bit of a turd to the punch bowl in the sense that I can't see myself half the time. And that's what's causing us to take a lot of this bad damage. But also our movement speed is still kind of doo-doo. Not when Bobby bombs. Grabs his head, showing us the big-time damage. And honestly, little Babadabba-ding-dong, I see you. I see you working over there. I like the hustle, son. Strength card, chariot card. Oh man, that is just too much damage, especially with us being guppy. Good night, Irene. Second round of the day, 3 Sierra, 1 Delta, 9 Quebec, Foxtrot, Quebec. The tiers upgrade, totally down for that. Definitely regretting picking up Samson's Chain by now. And the lack of keys has definitely been noticeable. But obviously when you take, you know, Guppy's Tail, it's to be expected. But come on, it was an early run Guppy. I mean, like, almost as early as it can get. Far away from the explosion there. We'll head on down. Now, if you want to talk like old school, for me, old school is not... It's not the Jetsons or Flintstones or whatever. It's like the Simpsons. Now later Simpsons. The Simpsons really is it's a show that is kind of the opposite of everything, of every point that I was just making for my own personal taste. Which, by the way, I want to say that if you are, like, again, fans of any of these shows, you just love them to death and you think they're the funniest thing ever, look, I ain't gonna hate you for it. All right, it's just not my type of humor, I guess. No, but if that makes you laugh and you have a good time with your mom and dad watching those shows, you know, then hey, I who am I to hate on that, right? But The Simpsons is a show that was not funny and got very funny and then is now not funny again. Although, to be fair, I haven't watched a modern episode of The Simpsons in a long time. Like, long time. Probably since I started doing YouTube, honestly. So I can't really speak for how funny it is in this day and age. But I do know that everything from, like, season 3 to season 10 is... And maybe even further than that, season 12 is, like... You know, I mean, that's just... That's my kind of humor for some of those episodes. Not all of the Simpsons episodes are funny, but some of them are. I love classic Simpsons episodes. Well, so far, we've been doing a pretty good job of not getting hit, despite the fact that we haven't gotten any HP in a while. An HP here. I'm going to see the devil deal, and it's going to be the Satanic Bibble. Honestly, I really think that Krampus's head's doing gangbusters for us, so I'm gonna take Krampus's head. Where's the XL? Hooray! So we have duality, which is going to allow us to take angel deals now. Assuming that they spawn, which now that we've had first the XL pretty much means we won't see one until probably the depths. I'm just throwing it out there. I'm just being real. And so far, so good. Two full floors and counting of not seeing any key. Again, to be expected when you've got Guppy's tail, but one every now and then would be nice, or just give us like skeleton key or something, because I really hate passing up on all these freaking rooms. Now, music is a different story. Music transcends the ages, in my opinion. Oh, we just straight up found the bosses, huh? I think music is relatable for pretty much anyone and everyone, if you're a music lover. Actually, not going to take experimental treatment. I don't think it's going to help us out. We didn't, of course, get a double deal or angel deal. It's the worst time for us to possibly get an XL floor, and I guess we're just going to head on down. I mean, we don't need any other items, but it would have been nice to go to, like, an item room or two. What are some other mediums that kind of transcend the ages from the eras, not ages, the era from whence they are from? I bet some people will probably want to say food. I disagree with that. I think that palates change over the ages. You know, one of my favorite channels to watch, this may surprise you. I mean, it surprised me because I didn't know that I'd love a channel this much that's just nothing but educational stuff. But one of my favorite channels is, and I'm drawing a blank on it, Townsend's. Townsend's? He's basically like the world's greatest history teacher, and he explores specifically the 18th century. I think John Townsend's is the name. And basically, oh wow, we get the D sizzle. Basically, he started out doing just the foods of the 18th century, and then like he sort of like has evolved into this educational channel that's like very, very. It's presented in a very, it doesn't dumb anything down, but it's also, it doesn't try to like be super fancy with it. Like he seriously talks like the best history teacher that you would ever possibly want in life. In a very endearing way. And so he'll cook like some stuff from like the 18th century and you know, and he doesn't pull any punches when it, like he thinks it's good or bad. He's like, yeah, he'd say stuff like, yeah, this was probably good back in the day, but, I mean, he doesn't say it that way, but you know what I mean? You know, he acknowledges that some of the food may not be quietly accurate, back then, but it's close enough that we can approximate here. approximate. So I know that food is kind of canceled out of there, but I think music was one of the only mediums that is sort of like transcends the era. Literature is another one, I would say. Play, like theater, I guess. I mean, I've never been a theater guy. I've never been big on the theaters, on the theater arts. And don't even get me started on musicals. Your boy does not like musicals. I'm sorry. If I had any perspective, you know, dates out there that was like, oh, St. Victor's the greatest. He just needs to, just one more thing. He just has to like musicals. And if that ruined it, I apologize. I'm sorry. I shattered the fantasy. You know, I mean, just the way that musicals are delivered is just they're every three scenes we're breaking into a new song, man. I don't care about this one, you know. Just tell the how about you just tell the story. Or let me know when you're done singing. How about that? I mean, I can appreciate how much talent it takes to be in like a musical production, but like, man, I get conjoined anyway, which is fine because I mean we've got serious liquid, so it's okay. It's no problem. Who am I kidding? There's nobody. There ain't nobody out there fantasizing about St. Victor or dating St. Victor. And if you are, I don't want to know about it. Just to make that point abundantly clear. That's my own comfortable headcanon. I'm sticking to it. Luckily, I never dated a girl who was super duper into theater. Because, you know, I mean, I guess sort of compromise and put up the facade that, oh yeah, it's quite interesting, but like deep down I'm like, man, I wish I was watching football. Or man, I could be recording Isaac right now. I'm just being honest. All I ever can be, man. There's too much fakeness going around in the world. Content creators especially, man. You had some. I don't even know what to call them. You got some jokers in the content creation medium. In the content creator space. You got some good people, you got some great people, and you got some awful people. Really don't have the keys to be wasting on just, you know, walking by locks, Isaac, so I'm gonna need you to just strap that down a little bit. We need to put a handle on that, because we can't be losing keys at this point. Moon card takes us to the ultra secret room, and we're gonna have a reroll for it, so I'm down for that. Oh yeah. Stairway. Well, well, well. How you doing? Stairway is going to give us a free angel deal. Well, it's a guaranteed angel deal to get into. No, we are not taking a second Guppy's Tail. By the way, shout out to these teleportation chests. That basically means that we cannot get an angel deal here. So we're gonna have to wait to use that reroll on the next floor. We could take the doorstop. We don't need the damage anymore, but like I also don't like losing the damage very much. Hopefully we get a Yave here. We've been necesito muchoing a whole lot of Yaves. Spanish mosh pit. No, St. Victor! Look, I'm sorry. I'm sorry that I'm an Espanol ignoramus. I am what I am, man. I am what I am. You all, how long have you been, how long have you personally been watching the channel? Who do you think has been here the longest? Do you think you've been here the longest? What's the earliest video that you remember just watching me? Did you watch me back in the Minecraft days? The Delta Squid? You watch me doing GeoGuessr like by myself? Remember those days? I'm not going to use the reroll here because we're about to go get into the stairway. Let's see how really old school you are. Anybody remember the Lauder days? How about the Lauder days when they were on YouTube, my PvP videos from WoW? All those many years ago. What about Air Amazing? I know there's probably still people kicking around from the Heroes of the Storm era. What about from Dota 2? Always curious. But my point is that those of you who've been listening to me and watching me for that long, you should know, you kind of know me by now, you know? I don't put up a front. I don't try to be someone that I'm not. You know, if you ever see me at a convention and you expect me to be any different than I am from the last, like, what, 12 years I've been doing this now, then you know that that's not the case. At least those of you who've been watching me long enough. I calls it like I sees it. This industry I've seen a lot. And not all of it's pretty, that's for sure. But I pride myself in knowing that I've created a very awesome and legendarily amazing community that other communities take note of and have started to emulate. That's really cool. I'm very proud of that, and I'm very proud of all of you as well. Because, I mean, you can't just have a one-man community. That just doesn't make any dang sense. What are you talking about? Craziness. Well, any idiot can strap a microphone to a stand and start talking into it, you know. But it takes more than one special person to make up a group of people who are very, very awesome, very generous, very understanding, very supportive. And the mosh pit is, with maybe a little bit of bias in here, I think the mosh pit is one of the pinnacles of those descriptive terms that I just got done using. And if you don't believe so, hey, just take a look at some of the Twitch streams, take a look at some of the YouTube streams. I mean, we, you know, The generosity of the mosh pit is legendary. The support is legendary. And after I'm done streaming, people go and support other people's streams. You know, that's really awesome. It's something to be, that's one of my most proudest achievements, is knowing that I built something from nothing. I thought we went down the hole for a second. I was about to be real mad. Because I can't, like, I haven't been able to see Isaac for, like, an hour now. Almost an hour. Got Seraphim. We got Angelic Prism, if I can ever find the pedestal. Well, head on down. Oh, I forgot about the reroll. Doesn't matter. Been a banter-heavy, banter-rich episode today. Again, what can you really expect on a run that started like this? You start with 15 damage. Hopefully it's been enjoyable. I've been enjoying it. Hopefully you've been enjoying playing the seed. Hopefully you've been enjoying the commentary. Hopefully you've been enjoying your day. Definitely don't forget about Thusmas. Again, it's just, I will be joining the show late, so I don't know if, I'm not sure if Hutz is just going to do a solo Thusmas, which wouldn't make any sense, but No, it's in our contract. We're allowed to explore other ways of delivering the show. For the record, there is no contract. That was one of the jokes that we made. That was a long-running joke in the NLSS. Is that we all had to sign waiver contracts and dispute pay and stuff with Ryan. And people actually bought into that. People were like whenever I left the crew, like I started doing other stuff other than the NLSS, people were like, oh, did they fire you? Did they void your contract? And of course, me being me, which is, you know, I'm kind of a smart aleck. I'm like, yeah, man, it was rough. But people like they bought it. They thought that that was true. Like, no. We don't have there's no NLSS contract. I hate to spoil it for y'all, but there's no NLSS contract. Or maybe there is. You know, there's not. Or maybe there is. No. Proptosis feels like a bad idea. It was severely nerfed in Repentance. Surprise, surprise. Should get a ladder, right? Oh, okay. Well, I think we did, but I may have screwed it up. Anyway. Sure, we'll take chocolate milk. Squeezy. What time you showed up, Squeezy? That's pretty good. That's pretty good. I'm Arthur Morgan. That's pretty good. I gotta play more Red Dead. All this horse racing on Zed Run has me wanting to see Little Sissy again. Little Sissy was named my horse in Red Dead Redemption 2. One of the best games ever. Which I never finished, but I should. Yeah, that's a whole metric butt ton of damage right there. Once again, we're not going to have a reroll here, but just get the miter for the second time. That's fine. Yeah, it's fine. It doesn't matter. We have an emperor card here. We're having fun. Enjoying life on a Thursday. Seeing the most ghosts I've ever seen to pop out of the hot room like that. You know what? Shout out to the Curved Horn for sticking here for the entire run with us. We held on to Curved Horn for the entire 53 minutes and 8 seconds of this video. Well, whatever the run has been, but you know what I mean. Get Shoop to woo. I don't think Shoop is a good play here. It's not gonna matter because I mean we just destroyed Isaac. All right, the final floor, possibly. Look at virtues, huh? Take Salvation. Guess I'll take Dead Dove. We pretty much have to, so it's your choice in the matter. Hard Zit, Scapegoat, Polydactyl. Doesn't matter. Wrap it all up. We're going home. Thank you for watching, everyone. Hopefully you enjoyed this banter-rich episode of The Binding of Isaac, Repentance here in the Mosh Pit. Again, thank you all very much. I hope you had a great start to your Thursday. Remember, I will be late for Thusmas tonight at the time of this recording anyway. And as always, thank you for liking, commenting, and subscribing. Sincerely, I really appreciate it. It only takes less than a second to click the like button. Leave a comment down below. It can literally say whatever you want it to say. It still supports the channel in the algorithm's eyes, and it helps a lot. And as always, I'll see you all next time. Until then, so long, everybody. Thanks for watching this video. I'd like to thank some patrons of mine like Relat01, Troy Mason, Dragoroth, Buzzkill, Lauren Strand, and Missy. If you'd like to have your name read at the end of an Isaac episode, then check out my Patreon campaign, which you can find over at patreon.com/Sinvicta.